by with the crowd, and it stirred his emotions. Oh, even this place is all I have. Should he even try?
Thank you. Revelation chapter 21. And since the message will be coming from the whole chapter, I dare not read the whole chapter. Just a few verses in our introduction. It's Revelation 21. By the way, it's Revelation, not with the S. Revelation 21. John says, "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and the sea was no more. And I also saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared like a bride adorned for her husband." I want to talk about the nodes of New Jerusalem. The nodes, the N-O's of New Jerusalem. God bless you, God bless you, God bless you. The nodes of New Jerusalem. Just want to remind those of you who are viewing by means of Facebook that we just, prior to our live stream, we just finished with our offertory period. And we also encourage you and invite you to participate virtually in the offering of gifts. You may do so by using Givelify or PayPal. And if you want to do the old-fashioned way, the U.S. mail, at least it was yesterday, U.S. mail was still running. And so that address is New Hope Baptist Church, P.O. Box 205, Covington, Georgia, 30015. The nose of New Jerusalem. In the beginning of Revelation 21, we read, "Then John says, then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away. Right. And the sea was no more. And I also saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared like a bride adorned for her husband." It is the introduction of the grand finale of God's plan of salvation. In Genesis 1 and 2, we have a picture of God's creative acts and the establishment of the human project on earth. The signature verses are Genesis 1 and 26, where the record says, "And God saw everything that he had made, and behold, it was very good." And I want you to remember that, because a lot of people complain about how bad this world is. Right. But the record says, when God saw everything that he had made, behold, it was very good. Right. If we were to pay attention to the news and the media, we would think that this world has already gone to hell in a handbasket. Mm-hmm. But there's still some good in this world. Yes, sir. There's still some good going on. Amen. And you know, it's sad, but good news don't make the news. Amen. Good news. I was inspired yesterday as I was listening to CNN. And they told of a story of a young man who left San Francisco and traveled all the way to the Ukraine just to help. Mm-hmm. There's still some good in this world. And you know, God has a way, when there's evil around, he has a way of making good amplify. You do know that the stars shine all the time, but you only see them in the middle of the night when there's darkness. And so I want to encourage you, because we're living in dark times right now, but the stars are still shine.
Yes, sir.
Yes, God saw everything that he had made, and behold, it was very good. And then Genesis 2:25, we read, and the man and his wife were both naked and were not ashamed. And so, they're perfect chapters, Genesis 1 and Genesis 2. But from Genesis 3 until Revelation 20, the Bible tells the story of rebellion, sin, corruption, and lost. It is a story of how the goodness of God was corrupted and distorted, and how the story of how humanity became ashamed of its nakedness. You know, the story is really so simple, but we have made it complicated with our creeds and doctrines. The purpose of God's plan of salvation is redemption. Redemption involves not a new plan or a new destination, but rather a restoration or a rescue to restore God's original intent, as outlined in Genesis 1 and 2. Therefore, the ultimate goal of God for humanity has never been a disembodied existence in a spiritual heaven, but rather the restoration of paradise on the physical plane that God created in the beginning. Thus, John's revelation of the new heaven and the new earth is representative of the full circle whereby God restores his original intent for humanity. Notice, if you please, the location markers in the text. John said, I also saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem. What's it doing, John? It's coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for a husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne. And what's it saying, John? It's saying, behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them. He will be their people, and God himself will be with them as their God. The New Jerusalem, which will be our eternal abode, will not be in a disembodied spiritual location in some faraway place beyond the sky. And I think this is where oftentimes in traditional Christianity we have missed the real good news. Don't get me wrong, it's good news to die and go to heaven, but it's going to be even gooder news, if there's such a word. It's going to be even gooder news to know that one day these very bodies that we have now will be restored. No more pain. No more rheumatism, no more physical maladies, but these very bodies will be restored like new.
Right.
And we'll live on the earth forever. The new earth. And so, we sing it. Heaven is my home. But that's not what the Bible says.
Uh-huh.
The Bible teaches that those who are in heaven right now, that is temporary. Because it says when Jesus comes back, he will bring them with him.
Right.
And then he's going to resurrect their bodies from the earth, and those spirits are going to be rejoined with their bodies, and so we shall forever be with the Lord, not in the sky, but on the new earth. That's good news.
Right, sir.
That's good than what most folks have been preaching.
Right.
At least it is to me. And so to emphasize this point, it is mentioned three times in just one verse. Look at it. In verse 3, Revelation 21 and 3. In verse 3, it's thrice stated. The tabernacle of God is with man. He will dwell with them. God himself will be with them as their God. Now, tradition would have us to believe that our eternal home will be in a spiritual realm with God in a place called heaven, but the Bible says that our eternal home will be in the physical realm with God being with us on earth.
Right.
And so that's why it's imperative. You see, what has happened is that we have been bedoozled, we've been befuddled, we've been bamboozled by the enemy, because the enemy is saying, well, you know, ain't nothing good in this world, so just let it go to crap because he's going to heaven. But you see, God, listen, the reason why have you ever wondered why when you first got saved, you didn't just die and go to heaven? Have you ever wondered why you're still here? Some folks are just waiting. And it's all right to wait, but you need to work while you wait. See, that's the problem. We've been waiting, but we haven't been working. What kind of work do we need to be doing? We need to be working to make this world, yes, this world, a better place.
Right.
And I want to suggest to you that one of the reasons why the world is in the shape it's in now is because we, traditional Christianity, has just given up. Mm-hmm. Well, this world ain't my home. You know, I'm just gonna let the devil have it. But God left you here. He says you what? You're salt and you're light. He left you here. We are here to make this world a better place. And yes, there will always be evil in this world. There will always be corruption in this world until God restores it. But in the meantime, it could be better than what it is if we don't give up. So ultimately, it's not about going to heaven, but it's rather about heaven coming to us. That's why we're encouraged to first seek the kingdom of God and to pray, thy kingdom come. Oh, what a wonderful and glorious picture John presents in Revelation 21. And while I am impressed by what is present, the streets of gold, the foundations of precious jewels, I am even more impressed by what is not or what will not be present.
Yes.
For as we look at Revelation 21, there are at least seven no's that capture our attention. First of all, in verse 1, John said there was no more sea. Now, to John's original, that don't mean much to us, but to John's original audience, this was real good news. For the ancient Jews, the ancient Hebrews were not very fond of the sea. For to the ancient Jews, the seas represented mystery and terror. They dreaded the sea because to the ancient Jews, the sea was an impassable barrier, a separating gulf, and a mystery that incited fear and dread. Even as John writes this, he's in exile on the Isle of Patmos, and he's separated from his beloved church at Ephesus by the sea.
Yeah.
And so John said there'll be no more sea. And not only was the sea the epitome of separation and isolation for the ancient Jews, the sea was also symbolic of chaos and confusion. That's why Isaiah, in Isaiah we read that the wicked are like the troubled sea. You know some folk like that? Always suffering. Never at peace. Never tranquil. Never quiet. Always something going. Time to get over something is something else. I mean, that life is so chaotic, that when you see them, you really wish you could become invisible. I know you're not going to admit that, but there are some folk that, you know, when you see them coming, you know, you want to hide and hope they don't see you. Life full of chaos and confusion. But the Bible says the wicked are like the troubled sea. Therefore, when John said there was no more sea, that was real good news for the ancient Jews. In verse 4, John said there will be no crying, for God shall wipe every tear from their eyes. Oh, my friends, won't it be grand when we won't have to cry anymore? As you look around the world today, many people are crying. They are crying in Ukraine. They're crying in Sudan, many other African nations. And they are crying because, and we are crying because they are crying. I don't know. You know, it's hard to look at the news and see all these people who've been displaced from their homes and not feel something for them that breaks your heart. While we're complaining about the price of gas, they wish they had our problem. Right now here in the United States, there's not a day that goes by that some parent is not crying because of gun violence, drugs, or some other malady that is constantly plaguing our communities today. But John said in New Jerusalem, there will be no crying. Yes, God will wipe every tear from the eyes, and there will be no more crying, no crying, because there will be no death. No death in the sea. Oh, can you imagine that? No funeral homes. No medical examiners. No coroners, no casket makers. No hearses, no cemeteries, no grave diggers, no funeral directors, no professional funeral mourners. Yet we still have those today. All because there will be no more and no death. No death and no mourning. Ever since Eve looked upon the still face of her beloved son Abel, death has plagued humanity to no end.
Yeah, yeah.
For he said, it doesn't matter, it does not matter, it does not matter who you are, it does not matter how much money you have, or what your resources, it does not matter your financial disposition. Death is the common denominator of all humanity.
All right,
the Bible says death is an appointment for all. No one can cancel that appointment.
All right.
You can cancel your doctor's appointment.
All right, yeah, all right.
You can run from the IRS for a little while.
All right.
But you can't outrun death.
I hear you.
But the good news this morning is that one day death will die. And there will be no more death. No tears. No crying, no death, no mourning will be in New Jerusalem. And John also said there will be no pain.
Right.
No physical pain, no psychological pain, no trauma, no stress. But now out of all the no's we have and will discuss, this next one is the most interesting to me. For in verse 22, John said, and I saw no temple in the city. No temple in the city. In the Greek text, there are two words that are normally translated as temple. One is a word called Herion. This word normally is used to refer to the whole temple area, where the people gathered in the temple courts and where Jesus often taught. This word occurs some 71 times in the Greek New Testament. But the other word, the word called naos. Now this word was used in classical Greek to refer to the dwelling place of the gods. And in reference to the temple at Jerusalem, it referred to the sanctuary, the holy place, the holy of holies. This was a place that only the priest could go. And when the priest went once a year, they tied a rope around his ankle in case he messed up and touched the wrong thing or struck the dead, they could pull him out. The holy place, the holy place, the holy place, the place where the Spirit of God dwells. No temple in the city. And I know it's been a controversy for the last year or so because you know, folk even now are debating about, you know, coming to church or whatever, you know, and they want to be in the church and they want to feel the presence of God. But I read somewhere in the New Testament where it says that God dwells in us. Yeah, that we are the temple of God. Yeah, listen, nothing wrong with going to church, but if you can't get next to God without going to church, something wrong.
All right, that's right. All right.
The word that's translated as temple in our text is naos. There will be no temple in New Jerusalem because the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb will be the temple thereof. There will be no need for a place for God to dwell because God himself will dwell with and among his people in the city. Now the fact that there will be no temple in New Jerusalem also presents us and also tells us that there will be no quote unquote religious practices as we know them in New Jerusalem. And it might be a surprise to many of you, but listen, there is no mention of religious practices or religion in the Garden of Eden. We don't read of Adam building an altar.
Right.
We don't read of Adam making any kind of sacrifices. Why? Because prior to the fall, there was no sin. You see, the only reason for you need an altar, the only reason you need a sacrifice is to atone for sin. But if there's no sin, there's no need for an atonement.
All right.
So there was no religion in Genesis 1 and 2, and there'll be no religion in Revelation 20 and 21. The religion is in the middle, but we messed up. Yeah. What's going on here? Well, religion is something that man uses in his attempt to reach or to appease God. Now, the problem with religion is that man has always had a tendency to substitute religion for relationship.
Right.
And that's even a problem today. People substitute religion for relationship. They think, well, listen, I don't have to get along with you, but if I just come to church,
right,
it'll be all right.
All right.
Mm-hmm. See, that you got your religion straight because you're coming to church. And the amazing thing about it is that a lot of people who were so adamant about being in church, having good religion, were the same people who were brutalizing and being injustice against other folk, and they didn't have a good relationship.
Right.
Yeah.
Mmm. Mmm. I don't hear nobody.
Right.
Yeah. We've always had a tendency to substitute religion for a relationship, and not only with one another but with God.
Right.
But you see, God has always not wanted necessarily religion. God has always desired relationship. God has always desired fellowship with man. No, there will be no temple in the city because there will be no need for the symbol of reality when the reality itself will be present. Now, this also presents us with an interesting dilemma for many who major in end-time prophecy and eschatology, because many believe that before the end of time, before Jesus comes back, the Jews will have to build the third temple, signifying the consummation of the end time. But why would they build a third temple? Why would they build a third temple when we read in Revelation that there is no temple in New Jerusalem? I think we missed it when Jesus put his condemnation on the temple before he left. He virtually condemned the temple. And in the New Testament, we learn that we are the temple of the living God. And so it'll be strange, because my foreparents used to talk about heaven being a place where every day will be Sunday. But it'd be strange for every day to be Sunday and not have a church to meet for Sunday meetings.
Wow.
No temple in the city. John said, I saw no temple therein, for the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb are the temple of it. And then choirs, listen, I'll be through in a minute, but choirs sing about the fact that there will be 12 gates to the city. Oh yeah, three gates in the east, three gates in the west, three gates in the north, three gates in, 12 gates to the city. Hallelujah. There will be 12 gates, but verse 25 says, and the gates will never be shut. You see, traditionally, the reason cities have gates is for protection. But New Jerusalem will have no need for protection, because the very presence of God, and because all of the enemies of the kingdom will have been banished. Therefore, the gates will be open for access to all whose names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life.
Yeah. Hallelujah.
And then verse 25 says there will be no night. No night there. There was an old song, y'all not going to admit it because we in church, but there was an old song that said the freaks come out at night.
Uh-huh.
Some of y'all remember that. Yeah, you don't have to admit it. I know you remember.
All right.
Freaks come out at night. Well, there definitely won't be any freaks in the New Jerusalem, because there will be no night there. The concept of night, particularly in the writing of John, indicated spiritual darkness. New Jerusalem will be indicative of the Father, because the Bible says of God, God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. Therefore, since there is no darkness at all in God, there will be no night in New Jerusalem.
Right.
Oh, my friends, that's good news.
Yes, sir.
Because sometimes when the night comes, night seems so long, but there will be no night in the New Jerusalem. And then finally, verse 27 says, but nothing unclean will enter it, nor anyone who does what is detestable or false, but only those who are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. There will be no uncleanness, no person who is detestable or false, no fake news, no propaganda, no purposeful lies in New Jerusalem. The Greek word that's translated as unclean refers to that which is morally impure, profane, or unhallowed. It is also excluded from the city will be all who practice abomination and falsehood. Therefore, no unclean people, no liars will inhabit the city. Oh, that's good news.
Yes, sir.
Anybody ever been tired of being lied on? You won't be lied on in the city. No, I don't know how you feel about it, but I am encouraged by the news of New Jerusalem. None of the things and situations that presently plague us will be present in the New Jerusalem.
Yes, sir.
No sea, no crying, no death, no pain, no night, no uncleanness, no lying, and surprisingly, no temple. Right. For the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb will be the temple. For the tabernacle of God will be with men, and he will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will be with them as their God. Yes. Therefore, I want to encourage you, my friend, that right now in this world, we are surrounded by uncleanness. Yes. We are surrounded by suffering, death, and pain.
All right.
We are surrounded by tears.
Yes, sir.
For I heard somebody saying the other day that weeping may endure for a night.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
But joy will come in the moment.
Yes, sir.
But let's be honest about it. Sometimes the night seems so long. Sometimes the night seems as if it will never end. Sometimes you have to cry all night long. Yes, your pillows wet with tears. I know you're saying Jesus will fix it after a while, but you need some fixing right now. And so you're crying and your weeping endures throughout the night. But I heard John saying, not only will there be no tears, but there'll be no night. Isn't that good news? I heard someone tell John that the one who conquers, that is the one who overcomes, the one who remains faithful, the one who remains steadfast, will have this heritage. I'll be his God, and he will be my son. And I'm closing when I tell you that some of y'all want to see God saying, well done, thou good and faithful servant. But I'm not looking to hear that. I want to hear God saying, welcome home, my son. You've been faithful. Welcome home, my son. Come inherit the joy that I had for you since the foundation of the world. Yes, won't it be good news to be a new Jerusalem? Come through now. God bless your heart. Abraham said he was looking for a city. I don't know about you, but one of these old days, I'm gonna move. One of these old days, my dress gonna change. One of these old days, yeah, yeah, oh, yeah. I know. We're living in the land of some more. We got some more tears we got to shed. Some more crying we got to do. Some more pain we have to endure. Some more burdens we have to bear. But one day, all of us who have accepted Jesus as our Lord and Savior will one day live in a land,
yes, sir,
where there'll be no more crying,
yes, sir,
no more tears,
thank you, Jesus,
no more pain,
yeah,
no more suffering. And I know I'm about to get in trouble here, but you know, on Facebook a lot of times people post heavenly birthdays to certain folk, and I understand that. But they tell me of a land. I was asking him.
Yes.
They tell me of a land where we'll never grow old. No more birthdays in heaven. every day will always be highly happy. And no more. Goodbye.
Amen.
God bless you, my friend. If you want to inherit this, if you want to inherit and be a citizen in New Jerusalem, then the time is right now for you to accept Jesus as Lord in your life. Grace is hard. You might find that as an alarming statement, but grace is hard. You know why grace is hard? Because it's embedded within all of us to pay for what we get. You know how it is when somebody do something for you, what do you feel? Instead of you saying thank you, instead of you being, you know, accepting the gift, you always feel like you got to give something back to them. But God's grace, listen. We can't pay God for what he's done for us. But we can say thank you. And the appropriate response, the appropriate thank you, is living a life worthy of his grace. Worthy of his love. I encourage you, my friend, wherever you are right now, it's not too late. As long as you have breath in your body, today can be the first day of the rest of your life for a new beginning. And God will bless you real good in your new endeavor. God bless you. Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord.